The attack on Pearl Harbor on 7 December 1941 was clearly a tactical victory for Imperial Japan, leaving most of the U.S. surface battle line sunk or disabled, large numbers of aircraft destroyed, and casualties in the thousands. Yet the attack had not triggered the response the Japanese had hoped for, instead replacing the isolationism that had prevailed in the American public with a newfound resolve.
A date which will live in infamy.
The sleeping giant had awakened. But it would be some time before the Americans could reach parity with the Japanese fleet, and in the first 5 months after Pearl Harbor, the Imperial Japanese Navy ran rampant in the Pacific and Indian Oceans, seizing the Dutch East Indies, the Philippines, Burma, Singapore, Hong Kong, Guam, and landing forces on New Guinea. The Japanese seemed unstoppable as their rising sun spread its rays over an ever-expanding empire that seemed destined to turn the Western Pacific into a virtual Japanese lake. With morale at low tide, the Americans devised an audacious plan, subsequently known as the Doolittle Raid, that called for Army B-25B Mitchell bombers to take off from a Navy aircraft carrier for a bombing raid on the Japanese home islands. Although militarily insignificant, the raid proved that the home islands were more vulnerable than expected and caused a major shift in Japanese strategic planning, leading to a planned assault on Midway Island, some 1,300 miles northwest of Hawaii. By attacking a U.S.-held island so relatively close to the home port of the fleet, the Japanese expected the Americans to respond by counterattacking, thereby luring them out where a superior Japanese fleet could engage them in a decisive battle that would eliminate the remaining U.S. naval presence and force the Americans to cede the Western Pacific to the victorious Japanese. In many ways, the Japanese plan worked. The Americans indeed responded to the assault as the Japanese hoped, but not when they had hoped. U.S. codebreakers had broken enough Japanese operational messages to deduce that the Japanese were coming to Midway, and that allowed the U.S. fleet to sortie ahead of time as Task Force 16, led by the carriers USS Enterprise and Hornet, under the command of Rear Admiral Raymond Spruance, and Task Force 17, with Rear Admiral Frank Jack Fletcher in the USS Yorktown. With the Japanese unaware that the Americans had departed Pearl Harbor and were already waiting in the vicinity of Midway, the surprise initiative had shifted to the Americans. The hunted had become the hunter. Just before dawn, on the morning of 4 June 1942, Japanese aircraft began launching from the carriers Akagi, Kaga, Hiryu, and Soryu for airstrikes on the American garrison at Midway. Arriving at about 06:30, they attacked, causing heavy damage but not neutralizing the island's airfield. Believing that the U.S. carriers were still at Pearl Harbor, the Japanese aircraft returned to their carriers and began refueling and rearming with anti-personnel and high-explosive bombs for a second strike on the island. But as rearming continued, Japanese reconnaissance aircraft detected the American force, putting Japanese Admiral Chuichi Nagumo on the horns of a dilemma. Attacking the newly discovered ships would call for arming with torpedoes and armor-piercing bombs rather than those being fitted for land targets. The initial scouting reports had not identified any American carriers, so Nagumo did not know that Fletcher and Spruance had launched their planes earlier, and that they were already winging their way toward the Japanese ships. Besides the rearming dilemma, the recovery of aircraft from the earlier strike on Midway prevented the Japanese admiral from bringing his reserve squadrons up from the hangar bays to the flight decks. The result was a Japanese carrier force particularly vulnerable, with their flight decks and hangar bays encumbered by fuel hoses, torpedoes, bombs, and aircraft not ready to launch. American tactical doctrine called for a simultaneous strike by the devastator torpedo planes attacking from low altitude, the dauntless dive bombers cascading down from above, and the wildcat fighters dealing with the defending Japanese Zeros swarming around their carriers in what was called a combat air patrol. But on this fateful morning, to conserve fuel for maximum range, the American squadrons had not waited to form up after launch, and had gotten separated as they sought out the enemy forces. The torpedo planes arrived first without fighter escort, and forced to make their approaches long and straight at less than 125 miles per hour to launch torpedoes, suffered devastating casualties from pouncing Zeros and surface gunfire. One squadron, Torpedo Squadron 8 from the USS Hornet, lost all of its aircraft and all but one of its pilots, bombardiers, and gunners. The other squadron suffered devastating losses as well, with not a single torpedo detonating on target. The terrible sacrifice was not in vain, however. The attacking devastators caused the Japanese carriers to have to maneuver, complicating the launching and recovery of their broods of aircraft. They also forced the attacking fighters to expend much of their ammunition. Most of all, the lumbering devastators made such tempting targets for the Japanese fighters that nearly all of them dove onto the helpless Americans, leaving the skies above virtually empty. At the ideal moment, the U.S. Dauntless dive bombers arrived and, unimpeded by the preoccupied Zeros swarming below, commenced their deadly descent. Several bombs struck the Soryu, igniting many of the aircraft with their various loads of fuel and ammunition, turning the hapless ship into a raging inferno. The Kaga's flight deck was ripped open, exposing the hangar bay below and igniting fires that quickly engulfed the entire ship. A single bomb did most of the damage to the Akagi, leaving her a burning wreck as well. Only the Hiryu remained. As the Americans departed, the Hiryu launched 18 Val dive bombers and 6 Zero fighters that followed the Americans back to the Yorktown, where they were able to land 3 bombs that did serious but not fatal damage. A second wave of 10 Kate torpedo bombers and 6 fighters from the Hiryu arrived an hour later, successfully delivering 2 torpedoes. Despite these hits, the Yorktown remained afloat and seemed destined to survive until a Japanese submarine added 2 torpedoes to her misery. The destroyer USS Hammond, alongside the carrier to provide auxiliary power, was also hit with a 3rd torpedo, breaking her in 2 and sending her to the bottom. The Yorktown would remain afloat for 3 more days before eventually succumbing. Late in the afternoon of the 4th of June, a wave of Enterprise aircraft counterattacked the Hiryu, scoring several hits that caused her to share the fate of her 3 sister carriers. All 4 Japanese carriers sent to engage the U.S. Navy in a decisive battle at Midway now found permanent resting places on the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. Many historians cite this battle as the turning point in the Pacific War, arguing that the Japanese had lost the initiative and were forced to the defensive. Counter-arguments abound, but few would argue that the Battle of Midway was a clear-cut U.S. victory at sea. The Japanese lost 4 of their frontline carriers, along with hundreds of aircraft and more than 3,000 men, including pilots, air crews, and veteran flight deck personnel. By contrast, the U.S. Navy lost 1 carrier, 144 aircraft, and 362 men. A little more than 3 years later, some of these same sailors who had fought at Midway would witness the surrender ceremony on the main deck of the battleship USS Missouri, ending the world's most devastating war after crushing the tyranny that had started it. It is little wonder that the U.S. Navy commemorates this battle, recalling the momentous events, remembering those who sacrificed their lives in a critical moment of history, and celebrating the courage of those who took their ships and aircraft into the maelstrom of battle at a time when their nation needed them most. Often there is a bugler sounding taps at these commemorations, and as those final haunting notes fade into the wind, those who follow in their footsteps as today's sailors are reminded of the awesome responsibility they have shouldered and are inspired to find within themselves the same courage that won the Battle of Midway.
This episode has been brought to you by the members of the U.S. Naval Institute. Our members write, debate, and discuss key issues that ultimately strengthen the Navy, Marine Corps, and Coast Guard. Benefits include a subscription to our award-winning Proceedings magazine, discounts to over 1,000 titles from books published by the Naval Institute Press, and graphic novels from Dead Reckoning, a discounted subscription to Naval History magazine, special invitations to conferences and events, and access to 146 years of archival information such as historic photos, oral histories, and so much more. For more, go to usni.org/join.